Welcome to the debate of the numerical miracles of the Quran. We have our Muslim representative, which is Dr. Shabir Ali, and we have our Christian representative, Richard Lucas. We're going to start off with Shabir Ali, who's going to have 5 minutes to discuss the open points.
Hello everyone, thank you for joining us for this interesting dialogue between Richard Lucas and myself on the question of the Quran as a mathematical miracle. I begin by praising our Creator and Fashioner. I ask Him to send peace and blessings upon all of His prophets and messengers, especially the last of them, the Prophet Muhammad, on whom be peace, after whose name Muslims traditionally say Sallallahu Alaihi Wasallam, which means peace and mercy and blessings of God be upon him. I'd like to thank Richard for agreeing to have this dialogue with me, and Al-Hikmah Media for making it possible for me to be here in the country to have a series of talks and dialogues, including this one with Richard Lucas here. So for this first 5 minutes, what Richard and I agreed is that we will talk about what we intend to do in the remainder of the dialogue and what we also expect from each other. Well, what I would like to present is that there are many numerical patterns occurring in the Quran, and these are best explained by saying that these are indications that the Quran has a divine origin. It's not just simply a human product. I will mention five areas in which I find numerical patterns in the Quran. First, there are words used in the Quran a number of times which seem to be meaningful in themselves, and this indicates intention behind the number of words used. Second, the chapter numbers and the number of verses within each chapter form very interesting mathematical patterns which are so complex that they point again to a divine involvement. Third, there are things in the Quran that are patterned after the number seven, so seven and multiples of seven. Fourth, there are things in the Quran which are patterned over 19. So 19 occurs and multiples of 19. And fifth, there are other incidental points which each by themselves are interesting, but they would have been mere coincidences had it not been for the overall scheme which we're seeing here. What would be interesting is to see that these patterns overlap and cross each other to form such a tight-knit system that if anyone changes anything in the Quran, these systems do fall apart, especially the relationship between the chapter numbers and the number of verses within each chapter. So this is where I'll go with the rest of this dialogue, by elaborating on these five areas in which I find numerical miracles in the Quran. What I expect from Richard are basically two things. One, I expect him to show some expertise in this area. Usually, when two persons gather to debate a subject, there are two experts in the field with different opinions, and this happens in almost every field. But they gather together to debate the issue, each to bring a critical but a scholarly perspective on the issue, and then we get a chance to see what are the best arguments for or against a certain proposition. It's usually not like one expert plus a critic who doesn't know much about the subject, but he only knows how to ask critical questions. So I'd like Richard to demonstrate some knowledge of the subject. And second, I would like to know from Richard, as a Christian believer, how he defines miracles, and what would he call a miracle, and how would his critical attitude towards the Quran as a mathematical miracle would play out when he comes to think about Christian miracles, whether it be the resurrection of Jesus from the dead, the virginal conception of Jesus, or more generally, how he thinks about the presence of life on earth and how that implies a creator. His arguments for intelligent design, more specifically, does that not imply a certain willingness to see the Creator's involvement in the patterns that we observe? And he's well aware, of course, that critics will say that such patterns do not involve a designer. Things just simply happen by chance. So that's what I expect from Richard. Altogether, I hope that this will be a very fruitful engagement, and that in the end, we will see that the Quran is really a miracle from God. Thank you.
Now we have Richard Lucas giving his opening statement.
Right, thank you very much, Shabir. Now last night, Shabir and I debated the topic of who exactly is God. And as often happens in Shabir's debates, the numerical miracles came up as part of the debate. And we were able to discuss it briefly, maybe at a greater length than in many of Shabir's debates. But I thought today it would be great to have the opportunity just to focus exclusively on the numerical miracles in the Quran. Now, I've watched Shabir presenting about the numerical miracles in the Quran many times to many sorts of audience, and I have to say, I can see why people find it convincing. If Shabir was given an hour's slot on primetime television in Britain to present the numerical miracles argument, from a Christian point of view, I would be worried. I would be worried that that would convince a lot of people on television watching it. And I've heard various arguments put forward against the numerical miracles as well. Now, I'm going to start off saying some of the arguments I've heard people make against them that I won't be using. I'm not saying they're entirely hopeless arguments, but they're not ones I'll be using today. I won't be saying that there's different versions of the Quran, slightly different. I don't think that's, that responds to it adequately. I'm not going to claim that it was rigged by a person. I don't think I need to claim that. I'm not going to say that just because these were discovered very recently, that means they can't have been part of God's intention. I don't think that follows. I'm not going to claim that because the verse numbers were added later, they couldn't have been part of God's initial intention. Again, I don't think that follows. But I would say with this, I could be convinced by numerical miracles in the Quran that God's hand was behind it. Now, as Shabir mentioned, I'm interested in intelligent design, and that approaches a similar question. It's the question of looking at evidence and seeing if it can draw the conclusion that intelligent agency was involved in producing what's before us. Now, this process of detecting intelligent input, the leading thinker in the area has been William Dembski, and he proposed what he called an explanatory filter that we can use, it's a very simplified account of it, to identify intelligent input, design, agency. And it said there need to be two features present to draw that conclusion. Feature number one, there must be specification. Now, a simple illustration would be, if you looked at the arrangements of pebbles on a beach, any arrangement is equally as improbable as any other. But if I saw an arrangement of pebbles on the beach that spelt out, "Hello, Richard," I'd say, "Hang on a minute, there's something going on here." That would be specification. There's some meaning, there's some purpose. In terms of biology, for example, if you look at the human eye, we can see that the components work together for a function. So that would be an example of specification. And the other component we need is complexity. Complexity is the component that rules out chance. It couldn't just have happened by coincidence. So if I'm aged 47 and I go along and happen to be 47 pebbles on the beach, well, that's not unlikely enough. It needs to be more unlikely than that for us to infer intelligent input. Now, William Dembski refers to the universal probability bound, which he calculates to be 1 in 10 to the power of 150, and says if a probability is lower than that, you really have to dismiss chance as an explanation. I don't think we need to go to that wild extreme of the universal probability bound. I'm willing to lower the bound quite a long way from there. So I said I could be convinced by something. Well, some things might convince me. If everyone out of every, of say, 17 prophets mentioned in the Quran is named exactly 37 times, I'd be interested. That would get my attention. I'd say, okay, I'll hear a bit more about this. If we number the letters from the beginning of the Quran, carrying on, and we took each prime numbered letter, and each letter spells out the Shahada, there's no God but Allah, and Muhammad is his prophet. If I saw that, I would be convinced. I would say agency was involved. I'd then ask the question, was it human agency or divine agency? But I would be convinced. I would make a design inference from that point. So Shabir's method is valid, but the question is, what he presents, is it specified, is it complex? I have to leave it there for now. Thank you.
Shabir Ali has 15 minutes.
So, thank you very much, Richard. That was a very engaging 5 minutes of specifying where we go here today. Following through from my 5 minutes before I get into the details of the 5 points I wanted to elaborate on, let me comment on my two demands before Richard. First, I asked him to demonstrate expertise in the area, and what I would expect is that he would have said, okay, I've studied the subject in detail to find out if in fact there are mathematical patterns in the Quran. And it seems to me that he hasn't done an independent study of this subject to see if indeed the Quran does have the mathematical miracles that we have spoken about. What he has done is that he said he's watched Shabir Ali, which could be a part of his education in the subject, but to me that's not the whole issue, and I'll explain why. And moreover, he has heard other people launching arguments against the idea that there are mathematical patterns in the Quran. To me, that's not giving it a fair hearing, and what is required for him to be an expert in the subject is for him to study the matter independently. Now, what would you need to study? You need to study some of these materials. Here is a book in Arabic called the Golden Encyclopedia of the Miracles of the Quran and the Prophetic Sunnah. There's a large section in here on the mathematical miracle of the Quran. Now, I don't expect Richard to know Arabic, and in fact, some of the materials which I'll be presenting are simple for any person who does not know Arabic to be able to deal with as well. You don't have to know much about the Quran to appreciate some of what I'm going to say. But to be an expert in the field to debate me on the subject, I would expect one to actually have this kind of expertise. Moreover, when I talk about words in the Quran and the number of times the words are used, here is a reliable source, the Majam, our Dictionary of Quranic Words by Fuad Abdul-Baqi, prepared several decades ago. Here you can find a listing of all of the words in the Quran and the number of times the words occur. Again, this is an Arabic resource. Don't expect Richard to be using this very efficiently, but that doesn't mean that he cannot be an expert in the subject. It just means that he has to acknowledge that these are things that he needs to study. Here is a work that is actually in English. This is a book entitled The Symmetric Book by Halis Aydemir. And the entire book is available for free reading on the internet. If you go to symmetricbook.com, you can see that book there. So I'd expect him to say, okay, I've studied this book and I know what Shabir is talking about, but I don't see the relevance of any of this. So I don't think that he's actually demonstrated expertise on the subject. Moreover, there are English resources available that I expected him to consult ahead of time and to be able to speak intelligently about these resources. One is the website tahil7.com, from which I've downloaded this 274-page book for free, and it's available to others as well. This details the patterns of seven in the Quran. So it's not a small study. The importance of what I'm demonstrating here is that often Richard is just simply responding to something I say. So I give one example, which has to be simple for the nature of the media and the audience that we're dealing with, and so he attacks the simple explanation. What he has to do is he has to go into the depth of this and then say that I've studied the matter in depth and I've come away thinking, no, there is nothing there. Just to attack the simple explanations is not really enough. And finally, I'd like to mention some materials that I downloaded from the website islamnoon.com. Islamnoon.com, most of their articles are in Arabic, but there are a couple of articles which are in English, which are downloadable for free, Quranic Studies series. First signs of numerical miracles in the Quran, and numerical miracles of the Holy Quran, chosen examples. So those are resources which are essential before someone can say, well, yeah, I've really studied the issue. As for what he is demanding to say, okay, well, you know, if I have to see this, then I would be interested. And he said, okay, I've lowered the bar from William Dembski's speaking about universal probability bound. He hasn't said why he's lowered the bar, and isn't that a little bit subjective? Like, how do you know somebody else might lower the bar even further from where Richard has lowered it to? So who decides to which extent the bar should be lowered? So Richard needs to specify these things, otherwise it turns out to be a bias against the Quran. He has obviously lowered the bar in order to accommodate some Christian miracles without his saying so yet. But then, why does he lower the bar to accept the Christian miracles, but he's not willing to look at the Quran with a non-Johnist eye? We will see that there are actually patterns in the Quran that even with a lower bar, as Richard spoke about, one should appreciate that this is a numerical miracle. Richard said there are 17 prophets mentioned in the Quran. I recall that there are 25, but I could be corrected. I myself am only a student of the Quran. I don't claim to know everything on the subject. So my five areas in which I find numerical patterns in the Quran. First, the words in the Quran are used a number of times, which indicate some intention behind the number of times that the words are used. For example, the word for day in the singular without suffixes is used in the Quran exactly 365 times. I find that remarkable. What are the chances you pick up a book and the book mentions the word day exactly 365 times? Usually they don't mention day many times, and if they mention it many times, why did they stop at 365, and who was doing the counting? In a similar way, the word for month, Shabir in the singular, occurs in the Quran exactly 12 times. It seems to be intentional. One of these issues by itself would have been just simply a coincidence that is not remarkable, but all of the issues that we're putting together make this remarkable. Words are sometimes used in contrast with each other. For example, hot and cold. Each is mentioned 4 times in the Quran. The word for man and word for woman in the Quran, Rajul in Arabic, Imra'a in Arabic, each is mentioned in the Quran 24 times. The Quran says that Jesus is like Adam, and it's so interesting that in the Quran, Jesus is mentioned by name 25 times, and Adam is also mentioned by name 25 times. The Quran's point is that God created Jesus just like God created Adam, but the fact that each is mentioned exactly 25 times it reminds us of this verse. Yes, Jesus is like Adam. Here's another way in which Jesus is like Adam in the sight of God. He mentioned both of them by name 25 times in the Quran. We often contrast angels and demons. It so happens that the word for angels in the Quran, malaika, is mentioned 88 times, and the word for demon, shayateen, is mentioned also 88 times, a perfect match. And the fact that these are mentions are scattered throughout the Quran, with some mentioned, some passages mentioning angels and some other passages mentioning shayateen, the question again is, who was doing the counting? And finally, I would like to add that the word for this life, dunya, and the word for the life hereafter, akhira, which are contrasting terms in the Quran, each is used 115 times. So again, a perfect match. If you imagine the Prophet Muhammad, peace be upon him, going through a period of 23 years with people asking him questions, and he's giving the reply to these questions, and sometimes both the question and the answer are included in the Quran, you see that the Prophet Muhammad, peace be upon him, could not control this or count the numbers of times that he's using certain words. So obviously there was somebody else keeping record, and to me that is the divine controller of the heavens and the earth. That's my first point. Second point is about patterns involving seven. Kahil7.com is the resource for this, where you can find many patterns described. We find things in the Quran that turn out to be multiples of seven. I'm running out of time, so I don't have the chance to give you my full description of this. But it so happens that the first mention of seven in the Quran is in the second chapter. The last mention of seven is in the 78th chapter, with an inclusive difference between the two chapters of 77, which is a multiple of seven. Likewise, the number of verses from the first mention of seven to the last mention of seven in the Quran is 5,649, which works out to a multiple of seven. It's 7 times 807. So we're seeing that things are turning out to be multiples of seven in unexpected places. My third area of inquiry is about things turning out to be multiples of 19. The first person who came up with this was Dr. Rashad Khalifa in the United States of America. But his study left a sour feeling among many Muslims, and then the topic was no longer being discussed for a while until some later researchers went back to the study and they said that even though Rashad Khalifa was mistaken on certain issues, there are certain facts about the Quran which are undeniable. The 19 occurs in many places to a surprising degree, which gives us the impression that there is a universal controller of the Quran to make it come out like this with multiples of 19. And as the debate proceeds, I will have a chance to elaborate on some of these issues. But I must move on now to the last area, which is to show some other incidental issues. The mention of thunder in the Quran is in two places in the Quran, and one place is in the second chapter of the Quran in the 19th verse. It so happens that in each place, the number of letters that make up this mention of thunder is 83 letters. So the question again is like, who was counting to make sure that, although the commonality between these two verses is that both mention thunder, but who was counting the letters? Because the words are very different between these two mentions. It seems that this is not by a mere chance, but incidental. I'd like to mention a further area, seeing that some time is still available to me. And this, to me, is one of the most amazing areas, though it's a little bit difficult to convey to a popular audience. But many Muslims are aware that some Muslims, instead of writing Bismillahir Rahmanir Rahim, which means in the name of God, the Beneficent, the Merciful One, they write the number 786. Where did they get this from? This goes back to the Semitic languages and the use of letters to indicate numbers. This is done in Hebrew, in Aramaic, in Syriac, and also in Arabic. So each Arabic letter has an equivalent. This is why in the Bible it is mentioned that David, following David there were 14 generations and then another 14 generations leading to Christ. Why 14 generations in Matthew's Gospel like this? The commentators say that that's because the name David corresponds to the number 14 when we take the value of the letters that spell his name. So in a similar way, the value of the letters that spell Bismillahir Rahmanir Rahim turns out to be 786. What we do find in the Quran is that the numbers that are associated with certain letters in the Quran actually give us some very interesting and complex mathematical patterns. Let me give an illustration of this. The word abiyad in Arabic means white. And the numerical value of the word abiyad is 813, following the similar principle I've already explained. It turns out that white and all of its derivatives are mentioned in the Quran 12 times, scattered in various chapters. And if we add all of the verse numbers where this word is mentioned, the total is 813. Is that a mere coincidence? And there are four chapters of the Quran which begin with the letter Ta. Ta-ha, Ta-seen, and Ta-seen, Mim. And what these surahs have in common is a detailed story of Moses beginning in each one of these chapters. If we look at the places where Moses and Aaron are mentioned, we will see, first of all, that Moses and Aaron together give us a numerical value of 377. Now, if we see where Aaron is mentioned throughout the Quran, and we add up all of the verse numbers where Aaron is mentioned, the total is, again, 377. Is that a mere coincidence? If we go to just these four chapters and we look at the verse numbers, I've mistaken myself. If we add up all of the chapter numbers where Aaron is mentioned, the total is 377. Now, coming to these four chapters in particular, that begin with the letter Ta, if we add up all of the verse numbers where Aaron is mentioned, here the total again is 377. Is that just simply another coincidence? More to the point, when we look at where Moses is mentioned and the number of times, and so we go Moses times the number of times mentioned, Moses times frequency plus Aaron times frequency, what is the result? The result is 7,163. Doesn't seem like a remarkable number related to anything we discussed until you realize that 7,163 is 19 times 377. So the 377 is hidden in there, and so is the 19, which I've already explained has some significance with the patterns that we're discovering in the Quran. So we see this very deeply in the Quran. And who kept count of this? Who worked out this formula so that Moses times the frequency of Moses plus Aaron times the frequency of Moses will equal 19 times Moses plus Aaron. This is remarkable. This is not by mere chance. This is by design. And it's not by design of any human being who worked with the Quran throughout its history. This is by the intelligent design. This is by the creator and fashioner of the heavens and the earth, the grand mathematician who made everything else. He revealed the Quran to us. Thank you very much.
Richard Lucas can rebuttal that.
Okay, thank you very much. Shabir, that's a very challenging speech. Now, I understand that the scientists have discovered, they haven't been able to discover any limit to the amount that can be stored in a human memory. I don't know what research they did to come to that conclusion, but just listening to Shabir Ali debate has led me to that conclusion as well. It's amazing. Word count miracles. Let's start with those. For word count miracles, in a sense, Arabic is the ideal language. Preparing for this, I had a look into how Arabic words are formed. I tried to look into it in some depth, and I came to the definite conclusion that I really hadn't got a clue. I really don't understand it. I don't understand Arabic. There's roots, there's lemmas, there's prefixes, there's suffixes. So, for example, on the Corpus Quran, the Leeds University online Quran, when I put in month, this is what I get from it. 21 uses, month, the month, is for the months, are months, the months, for 2 months, month, and the months, the sacred month, etc., etc., all those different ones. Out of that 21, through one criteria or another, Shabir is able, and Muslims are able to select 12 of them to claim that that's the 12 months, and that's got special meaning. Now, whatever the rule is that arrives at 12, it's interesting that there does need to be a rule to select from the 21 to get the 12. Similarly with days, at some like 471, there needs to be a rule to end up with the desired outcome of 365. Mentions of prophets. This is a little graph showing the number of times different prophets are mentioned in the Quran. I put the devil in as well there, just out of interest. So if you imagine I was a Muslim looking for numerical miracles, I'd say, right, if Moses and Muhammad were mentioned the same number of times, that would be brilliant. Right, doesn't happen. How about Moses and Jesus the same? No, that doesn't happen. Any others the same? No, what's the best we've got? Jesus and Adam quite similar. Jesus and Adam quite similar, let's go with that. According to when I put Jesus and Adam in, it says there's 28 citations for Adam, 25 for Jesus. But when you look through them, three of the ones for Adam seem to be from a different form of the word. So we'll say 25 each. Bingo, there's another alleged numerical miracle from the Quran. Now, so there's a bit of wriggle room with Arabic, I think, because it's very, the words are composed in very complex ways and counting them isn't a straightforward matter at all. But I decided to have a go myself to see if I could find some numerical miracles in the Quran. So I needed to settle on a method. And I decided on the method of counting uses of a lemma. Now, a lemma is a dictionary or citation form of word. In English, for example, run, runs, ran, running are forms of the same lexeme with run as the lemma. Okay. So I went to the online Corpus Quran, Leeds University, and I looked at the frequency of the use of lemmas. Now, Shabir wants to say, oh, that's the wrong method. Well, it'll be interesting to see how well I did with the wrong method compared to the right method. But my method is entirely transparent, and there's no wriggle room at all. How many times is each lemma used? Now, for the month list, for example, that I just showed you, by my method, that would be 21. I would count that as 21, fudging that at all. So how did I do it in my search for numerical miracles? Corruptors and deniers, 21 times each. Horrible evil equals death, 50 times each. Severe punishment for their wrongdoing, wisdom. Some Muslims might see something in that. All those words used 20 times each. Not mercy, 114, 114, number of surahs in the Quran, that seems like a special one. Sin is best or better. Enjoyment, all used 35 times each. Look at this next one. The Christians, same number uses as doubt, the revelation, message, glad tidings. But to be honest, I think I'm better at this than the Muslims who are finding them. This one's not so good from a Muslim point of view. Gospel of three, the most gracious, with flesh, but still a true monotheist. Is that not the Trinity? All those lemmas are in the Quran 12 times each. The cattle knows best. Well, I don't know if we can bother that one. Right, Adam and Jesus, I think Shabir has mentioned this one, 25 times each. Adam is mentioned, the lemma for Adam, 25 times. Sin and blame, 25 times. That seems to confirm the Christian doctrine of original sin. To me, Jesus, covenant. Christian theology, Jesus ushered in a new covenant, 25 times each. Muhammad's mentioned 4 times. So are all these words. Purer, purest, purer, unlettered. How about that? The unlettered prophet. Righteous, God-fearing, jihad of the war, forbearing his message. The Holy Spirit. Some Muslims claim that the prophecy of the Holy Spirit was really about Muhammad. Honorable, kind, most upright. Maybe you can make something out of those. These ones not so good. I don't think any Muslims want to point those ones out. So that's how I did it with the Quran, with an entirely transparent method. You can go on there and check. On the Corpus Quran website, there's a frequency list of lemma used within the Quran. So it will list all the lemmas that are used, say, 15 times, and you can look at all of them, and I've just selected the ones that seem to have some connection, which is the method that Muslims use. On to the next one. I thought, how about the New Testament? Let's try that. So I've got a similar list for the New Testament. Mercy, cross, and judgment. What better summary of Christian theology? 27 times each. When this goes on YouTube, I'll put the references to the websites where these lists are on if anyone wants to check them. Generation, offspring, 43 times each. Tomb, monument, end goal, tribute, 40 times each. Righteous, justice, peace. Whole, truth, 109 times each. Soldier, widow. Marriage, bridegroom. That's a good one. Suffering, not so good. Sacrifice, daughter. No, we won't bother with that one. We'll leave that one. But then I went to the Old Testament. Even better with the Old Testament. To go out, to return, 1,075 times each. To cover, to make atonement, and to forget, 102 times each. Dismayed, sing for joy. Sometimes Shabir presents words with opposite meanings that appear at the same time. To have compassion, to love, to murder, 47 times each. To die, to bereave, 24. How about this one? Land and possession, Old Testament, possess the land, 222 times each. Blessing, favor, grace, 69 times each. Now, why am I going on at such length about this? Because Shabir might reply, oh, there's not as many as there are in the Quran. So that's why I'm having to go on. End, grave, 67 each. God, praise, 58 each. Spear, wound, 48 each. Lion, lions, and sheep, the lion and the lamb will lie down. Harlot, sin, iniquity, wrath, salvation. Governor, red robe. In the New Testament, did the Roman governors wear a red robe? Very possibly. Young man, chariot. What does that result in? Fracture. And the last one, dog ball. We'll leave that one. So now I'd be slightly concerned at this point that maybe some Christians might say, oh, well, maybe there is something in this. Maybe the numerical miracles there do prove that God was involved in the Bible. So I've tried to find some other word frequency lists. Now, they're not easy to find. I just went on the internet and had a try. Shakespeare, find some for Shakespeare. Shakespeare's plays were listed in alphabetical order. I just went to the first one in alphabetical order. Antony and Cleopatra, heart and love, 38 times each. Men, women, 22 times each. Wars, peace, 16 times each. So I hope I've made it absolutely clear that these sort of word count miracles, so-called miracles, are not unusual and they're not miraculous. In the Quran, that's the number of words, number of unique surfeit forms, number of stems, numbers of roots, number of lemmas. Now, between all that lot, that's a huge search space in which to look for these word count coincidences. The other thing with a book like the Quran is it's got common themes through it, so the same words have been used again and again, which again helps the probability. I think with that issue, I really do think what I've shown you there is an absolutely convincing demonstration that what's presented as word count miracles from the Quran are not in fact miraculous. Right, moving on to the arithmetic miracles. I wouldn't call them mathematical miracles, they're arithmetic. This is the basic method used to find them, the things that divide by 7, 19, etc. Select an arbitrary quantity to count, So take some numerical values in the Quran and follow an arbitrary procedure. Just make it up what you're going to do with them. Divide them, add them, count between them, or whatever you're going to do. Divide the result by 7 and 9, or 19. If it works and it goes in exactly, add it to your list. If it doesn't work, can you fiddle it somewhere? Can you just change the way you count it very slightly to make it work? If you can't do that, then just forget that one. Back to stage one and try another arbitrary method of mixing the numbers up together, doing some sort of calculation, and test that one. Now, I'd be happy if someone wanted to dispute step four and say, no, we don't fiddle it. We don't try and fudge it if it doesn't work. I'd be willing to concede step four in some cases. But the overall method, I'm not willing to concede. That is the method used to find numerical miracles in the Quran. And that's the fundamental problem with it. Out of all the other things I've said, this is the main problem. I just want to illustrate the method to you with some dice here. So I can roll my set of dice in there. There they all go. So I'll have a look at that. And I'll say, for example, threes. So I could give them a sort out like this. All the ones that are not three, I could put over there, get rid of those ones. And I'm left with those ones there. And now I've got six. Six of them came through. So those ones I just forget. I can now present these to you and say, look what happened here. The green dice came out as a three. The pink dice came as a three. And as if that wasn't enough, amazingly, the white dice came as a three. And you've got, so what's the probability of all six of them giving a three? What, a six to the power of six. Now, spookily, I got six threes, and my slide does show six of them as well. What's the chance of that happening? 0.000214. It's miraculous. But you see the method. You've got a huge search space. How many ways are there of combining the number of letters in words, verses, surahs in the Quran, the number of verses, the chapters? You can add them, subtract them, multiply them, divide them, count up to, count after them, count between them, count from the beginning, from the end, from the first use of a word, from the last use of words, from the seventh use of a word, from the middle use of it. And you can keep combining those things ad infinitum, ad infinitum. And the things that don't fit, discard them. The things that do give you a result that you want, keep it. Now, Shabir referred to a 274-page document. I think he's referring to the marvels of the number 7 in the Noble Quran. I've heard Shabir make reference to that before. Now, in the introduction to this, the author lays out his approach. He calls it a scientific approach. There's nothing remotely scientific about this. He says it looks at the letter count in each word, the letter count in the first and last word in a verse, letter count of the words in a verse in accumulation. So letter count of the first word plus letter count of the first and second word, etc. Arrangements of particular letters across the words of a verse, and letters of a special phrase, and many more. The arrangements of the chapter numbers which in which a specific word in the Quran is found, as well as the verse numbers in which this is found. The diversity of numerical arrangements found in the Quran's first verse and the other Quranic verses, as well as that between the Quran's opening chapter and the other Quranic chapters. And it also has a system of assigning numbers to passages in the Quran using the example I gave there. I ate pizza today, one letter, three letters, six letters, five letters. You would take that as 1,365. Now, the author of this book, he's presenting this as though this is strengthening his case. He's saying, look how thorough I am. Look how many different methods I use. But he's not strengthening his case. He's shooting himself in the foot. He's demonstrating the weakness of his method, that he has to try so many combinations of methods to get the results that he wants. Now, a similar type of process can be seen. There's lots of things on the internet like this. I mean, the 9/11 coincidences. I don't know if you're familiar with this. People said the Twin Towers look like an 11. And they said, looking at the whole 9/11 thing, obviously it's got the date, the 11th. What else? New York City has 11 letters. Afghanistan has 11 letters. Rasim Yuseb, a terrorist who tried to destroy the Twin Towers, has 11 letters. George W. Bush, 11 letters. New York State is the 11th state. The first plane crash in the Twin Towers was flight number 11. Flight 11 was carrying 92 passengers. 9 plus 2 equals 11. Flight 77, also 65 passengers. 6 plus 5. Now you can see, I won't bother going through the whole thing, but you get the idea. How did someone come up with that? I mean, I could ask that later. What procedure did someone go through to produce this list. They just took all the numbers they could find related to the 9/11 attacks, tried to play around them to see, with them to see what they could do. Every time they came up within 11, it went on the list. Every time it didn't, it went in the bin. The Raven by Edgar Allan Poe, a famous poem apparently. I don't know much about poetry. Now, the first line says, "Once upon a midnight dreary, while I pondered, weak and weary." Now someone used this system to allocate numbers to the letters, similar to the one I just referred to. And this is the case. Again, looking at seven. Seven times seven letters. First and last words sum to 202 times seven, of which the first letters contribute 80 times seven. Consonants in the word that said, I won't read the whole thing. But again, you can see the idea. Even from that one line, someone can produce this huge list of numerical values that are multiples of seven. Now, when I talk about the word count, I was talking about a little bit of wriggle room. Now again, with the 274 page book that Shabir was referring to, I've just picked out two examples where a bit of wriggle room is evident. This is a quote from the book. The last chapter's number and the first chapter's number, last chapter 114, the first one number one, arranging these two numbers next to each other in logical sequence. What's the logical sequence to put 1 and 114 next to each other? Why did you put the 114 first? Now, obviously, it's a very simple illustration, but it's obviously the case. What would you try first? You try 1, and then you put 114. So you try 1, 1, 1, 4. You try that first. Is it a multiple of 7? No. Let's try them the other way around. Yes, it is. Exquisitely, this is a multiple of 7. The second one there, the first mention of the number 7, first mention in Surah 2, last mention in Surah 78. So if you look at those, how many surahs are there between the second and the 78? There's 75. It doesn't divide by 7. Okay, we'll leave that one then. What you have to add on to 2 to get 78? You have to add on 76. Is it a multiple of 7? No, right, forget that one. Let's try again. If we include both of them, we get 77. Multiple of 7, that's the one we'll keep. That's the one that goes in the book.
Time.
Okay, thank you.
And that should be ready in 10 minutes.
10 minutes, okay.
Yeah.
So, thank you, Richard, for engaging with some of the things I mentioned. Let's deal with what Richard said. He said that, he admits that he's not schooled in the Arabic language, and that I did not see to be a deficiency in any case. But when we come to this study, the study needs to be done in Arabic because we're talking about the occurrences of words in the original Arabic. And what one needs to do is to consult a module like this and to see the number of times the word is used. And one will go to the word for month, shahr, and one will see that there is a logical separation in the way that Arabic words are listed in this book. And you come to the word for month, and in the singular, you will find that it is exactly 12. And if you include, shahrain, for example, that's another 2. So 2 months is mentioned twice. So there's a logic behind the way in which the words are separated according to various categories, and the single category of month just gives us exactly 12. If he does the search using English, he comes up with 21, but there could be other reasons for that. Whereas, for example, shahrain is 2 months, as a single word in Arabic, it gets to be 2 words in English. So if you search for month, you will get month with these 2 occurrences as well. We need to go to the original Arabic to see what was mentioned there. 365 for a day, I don't think he disputed that. And in fact, if we were to now include all of the mentions of day, I've mentioned 365 as the singular without any suffixes, but if we include suffixes and plurals for day, we come up to 475. And 475 turns out to be a product of 19. It's 19 times 25. And that 25 has its own significance, which I don't have time to elaborate on now. So everything in the Quran seems to have some great significance, and these relate to mathematical patterns. Now, he says, oh, why not other prophets? Why only Jesus and Adam are given an equal number of times in the Quran? My specific point is that the Quran says in Surah 3, verse number 59, إِنَّ مَثَلَ عِيسَىٰ إِنَّ اللَّهِ كَمَثَلِ Adam. The example of Jesus in the sight of God is like the example of Adam. As such a statement is not made about the other prophets. It's made about Jesus and Adam, and it's similar. The two are similar, and they're similarly mentioned 25 times each. So that's the point. There seems to be deliberate intention here. In Richard Search, he came up with the amazing result that the word not in the Quran is mentioned 114 times, and that was equal to mercy, which is mentioned 114 times. Did you really mean that, Richard? Not is mentioned in the Quran 114 times?
In the Corpus Quran lemma frequency list.
Okay. Well, I think this will illustrate the paucity of that approach, because la in Arabic is actually very common, and it's very commonly used throughout the Quran. I'd be surprised to find that it's only mentioned 114 times in the Quran, but that, of course, requires some further verification. Now, he gives counterexamples from Shakespeare and from the Old Testament, from the New Testament, from the writing of of Alan Poe, and so on. But two things have to be said about this. First of all, one has to look at the patterns and say that this shows some significance given the context and so on, or that it's just a matter of mere coincidence. In the case of the Quran, we're given the context in which the Quran claims to be a miracle from God, and whereas the Prophet Muhammad, peace be upon him, is pressed to demonstrate all the miracles, his constant reply was that the Quran is his miracle, to the extent that every verse of the Quran is called an ayah, which means a sign that this is a revelation from the Almighty God. So within this context, we're asking, is there anything in the Quran to support that claim that it is a sign from God? And these are the supportive evidence that we find. Whereas if you go to Shakespeare or Alan Poe or any secular writing, what we find within there should be classed as coincidence, even if it's a remote coincidence, but yes, a coincidence. In the case of the Quran, a similar coincidence has a meaning in the overall context. This is the word of God, and this is not just a mere coincidence, but it is a sign that this is from God. A similar approach has to be taken with the miracles of Jesus that are reported about Jesus, or miracles that Christians continue to experience. If a Christian prays for God to remove his ailment, and then the ailment is removed, somebody may say from scientific explanations, this person did not have a miraculous cure from God. We can explain the removal of his ailment by various natural causes. But for that Christian, I prayed to God and God removed my ailment. This is a sign that God is with me. It happens within a religious context. The similar thing is with the Quran here, that the coincidences that we're noticing are within a religious context. So when the other part of this is when Richard says, well, look at sacrifice and daughter, it's mentioned the same number of times. But there's no significance to that similar number of times. That's a mere coincidence. But when the coincidence is such that you can see some significance to this, that is when it gives us cause for thinking that this is deliberate and obviously from God. Now, the counts that we're coming up with actually require very careful scrutiny to make sure we're not making mistakes when we count things. So it makes us wonder, how did anyone come up with this in the first place, to design a book like this? Because it's so easy to make an error even in our counting. Notice what Richard put up, the simple statement, I ate pizza today. He counted the word pizza as having six letters. But actually, if you think about it, the word pizza actually only has five letters, as it was easily seen from the screen that Richard put up. But that shows how easily either Richard or me or any human being can make a mistake. The question is, how does the Quran come up like this, with all of these patterns, with the patterns not being mistaken, they are still in place. Now, when Richard wanted to give examples of things working out to be patterned on seven, he gave very short numbers, for example, 94. Very short numbers, two-digit numbers and so on. But what Cahill has actually shown in his 274-page document is that large numbers can be concatenated to give the products of seven. And it's not just simply the 1141 that Cahill has given, but he has shown, for example, that if you look at the word nufika, which means is blown into, That word occurs 7 times in the Quran. So it's interesting from the point of view of looking for patterns of 7 in the Quran. Now, if you look at wherever this is mentioned, it's mentioned twice in a particular verse. So there are 6 verses altogether in the Quran where this is mentioned. If we put all of the verses together in the same order in which they occur in the Quran, and consider them as one word, removing the spaces between them, now you have a very long word made up of several digits. That number is a product of 7 twice. It's a product of 7 squared. And the chance of that number of being any number being a multiple of 7 twice over is 1 out of 49, because every 49th number is a product of 7 squared. Now, if we look at the chapter numbers where the word Nufiqah is mentioned, and do a similar concatenation of those numbers, merging them together to form one long string of numbers, with several digits in that string, that number 2 is a product of 7, but 7 4 times over. 7 times 7 times 7 times 7. 7 to the power of 4. And the chance of getting a number by random selection to be a product of 7 to the power of 4 is 1 out of 2,401. To get both of these results where the word Nufiqah is placed throughout the Quran, the chance of that is 1 out of 117,600. And that's more than the number of words in the entire Quran. You notice that Richard put up the number, he said 77,000 and change of words in the Quran. So 1 out of 117,000, that denominator is greater than the number of words in the Quran itself. So to find this word Nufiqah placed where it is in those specific chapter numbers, with those specific verse numbers, this is rather remarkable. It's a very rare coincidence. And when this occurs within the context where the Quran says, وَلَقَدْ أَعْتَيْنَاكَ سَبْعًا مِنَ الْمَثَانِي وَالْقُرْآنَ عَظِيمٌ, we have given you the 7 oft repeated things and the grand Quran, that gives us reason to think about the 7 and its significance in the Quran. And it turns out that chapter and verse number where this is mentioned in chapter 15, verse number 87, when concatenated in the logical order as well, the way it occurs in the Arabic text, that gives us a product of 7 as well. And Abdul Daim Kahil has shown that this way of looking at the Quranic numbers works out again and again. So it's not that you try one thing and then you try another thing, as Richard is saying. No. The authors may have tried various things, but once they arrive and they've discovered what the pattern is, they see that many instances conform to that same pattern and give us amazing results dealing with very large numbers. That people would not have been able to see the bottom of, but we can see it now with our modern computer system. Thank you very much.
And now Richard will have 10 minutes to respond.
Okay, yeah, just ignore the slide for a minute. I'd like to start replying to some of Shabir's points there. Now, in terms of the setup, I'd be willing to lower the bar a little bit from the universal probability bound. I think Shabir must have misunderstood when I was saying that. Within the explanatory filter, for something to be complex, William Densky suggested that if its probability is lower than 1 in 10 to the power of 150, then chance can be dismissed as an explanation. I was actually saying I would be more generous to the Quran. If something was just 1 in a million, 1 in a billion or whatever, I might be prepared to take that seriously rather than this outrageously one with 150 zeros after it instead. So I think Shabir misunderstood what I was saying about the probability there. Now Shabir, he said, I gave the example of what would convince me. I didn't actually say the 17 prophets mentioned in the Quran. That was just an example that I made up. Now, Shabir, I'm sure I misunderstood him, because he seemed to be saying that it's not just they find multiples of sevens in small numbers, they also find very big numbers that are multiples of 7. Of course, the probability of a number being a multiple of 7 is independent of the size of the number. I'm sure Shabir absolutely realizes that, but it seemed to be what he was saying. Now, Shabir was saying, what about all these books? Have I read all these books? Have I studied it all in depth? I suppose I could respond to Shabir by saying, How much have you read about astrology? There are mountains of books about astrology, about how star signs work, how they influence your life, how you interpret them, etc., etc. I would ask you, have you read them? Have you studied that in great depth? I haven't. No, I've dismissed it because I can see the principle behind it, and it's flawed. I've got three books here. One on coincidences in the Bible and Biblical Hebrew, the Bible Codes, popular a few years ago, Ivan Panin's Numerics in Scripture, and they contain Christian versions of what Shabir is presenting tonight. And it's identical in its format, in the method, and it's presenting the same sort of statistics as evidence of divine activity. Now these books, I don't have to read all of them. I just have to have a little look, get the flavor. I can see what method they're employing. I then don't need to read the next 250 pages of contrived arithmetic coincidences that have just been plucked out. I don't need to read the body of it. I can see the flaw in it, and so I don't need to study it all in great depth. Now, in the debate last night, Shabir said that there's a special numerical miracle in a particular surah. I think it was the shortest surah that was mentioned. And Shabir said he couldn't quite remember what it was. And I replied by saying, doesn't that just demonstrate that it's a special rule for the miracle in that surah, but it's not, it's a different rule for all the others, it's not being consistent. And Shabir replied by saying, if it was a consistent rule across all of them, we'd think someone had done it, someone had rigged it. And I replied by saying, yes, we would be more likely to conclude that. Because if the same pattern is repeated across a wide range, that's more convincing evidence of intelligent input than a different pattern in lots of different cases. But then today Shabir seemed to be saying the opposite. He seemed to be saying the fact that a pattern carries on and is repeated in different contexts is evidence for it. Now Shabir questioned my word count method with the Quran. I counted lemmas. Now, if you dispute that method, if that method is invalid, isn't it interesting how well I did with an invalid method? Because I think I did just as well, if not better, than what's actually presented by Muslims as the word count. And also, if you're questioning that in my method in the Quran, it worked in the New Testament, it worked in the Old Testament, it worked in Antony and Cleopatra as well. Now, Shabir made the point about it's not just a certain number of, it's not just the fact that a word's mentioned the same number of times. It's got to have significance. It's a special significance in the context that moves it into the realm of the miraculous. Mercy, judgment, meet at the cross. Okay, if you gave me a slot on God Digital TV, I could have a lot of Christians eating out of my hands with this, because they would see that so clearly as summary of the message of the New Testament and their word counts from in the New Testament, some of the others as well. So mine equally fulfill the criteria that Shabir gave. My ones from the Quran equally fulfilled Shabir's criteria. I mean, this one here, the Christians doubt the revelation. I mean, what could be clearer than that's expressing something that is the message of the Quran and of Islam? And it's not just the revelation, also the message and the glad tidings. I say, I really do think I've done better at this than the people who actually do it for real. Now, I think Shabir questions what I say about this idea that you keep the ones that work, you discard the ones that don't work. So I'd like to ask you a bit, do you really believe that the people, for example, that the book I mentioned, the 274 page book, I forget its title, do you really believe that the author of that didn't have any failures along the way? Just to give the one example, when he did the 114 and then put the one after it, do you really think he didn't try it the other way around first? Do you really think he thought it was exquisitely logical to put them in reverse order, or did he test it first? It's obviously true that he tested it the other way around, it didn't work, so then he tried it the other way. I was interested in Shabir's discussion of faith there. I thought that was quite a concession. He was saying a Muslim would look at these miracles through the eyes of faith. So whereas, for example, if a person recovers from illness, they might think that was a physical thing, maybe a medical procedure, but they also might interpret it as God's hand. And I think that's absolutely fair enough. That is the faith perspective on things. But if you're bringing the faith perspective in here, that completely holds it below the waterline as a form of apologetics, as something to present to people as evidence for the Quran. If you need to bring faith into it like that, then it doesn't operate in the way that Shabir appears to use it, which is to convince people that the Quran is the word of God. Right, I have to leave it there.
Thank you. Now we're going to have a 20-minute discussion between Dr. Shabir Ali and Richard Lucas. They're going to ask questions and speak.
Okay, so how do you want to moderate that in a particular way? You want to do like as you did last time?
We have
a 3-minute, we ask questions, 3 minutes,
do you want just an open discussion, which is what initially we
agreed on? Okay, Richard, I didn't have a chance to discuss the relationship between the chapter number and the number of verses within each chapter as I did last night, and I noticed on your slides that you're prepared to answer me on that point. I'd like to explain it again in perhaps a slightly different way, in the way actually in which my sources do explain it, and I've tried to put it in a simpler way, hoping to convey it to a popular audience. But what they have explained is that you look at the chapter number and you look at the number of verses within the same chapter, and the numbers are obviously either odd or even before we even add them. So you look at the two numbers in question for each chapter, and you observe, are they both even? Are they both odd? In which case there is a match with respect to oddness or evenness. So put all of the chapters that have this match together in one group. What about the mismatch, where there is an odd number on one side, even number on the other side, or the reverse, even number, odd number? So if one of the numbers relating to the chapter is odd, the other one is even, we put all of those chapters into another group. They call them homogeneous and non-homogeneous. So now we have two groups of chapters. Interestingly enough, we have 57 chapters in each group. Now that's a minor coincidence, but the most major thing is that if we take the 57 from one group that has the homogeneous chapters, the homogeneous numbers, then those numbers altogether total the same as the number of verses within the entire Quran. And as you rightly pointed out, it follows that the other group of chapters will produce the numbers which total the chapter numbers of the entire Quran. But the question is, why did we get this remarkable second coincidence? And in fact, the two together, because each one is, by the laws of probability, the first one is what we might expect, although by a real physical toss of a coin 114 times, you may not get 57 and 57 heads and tails, but you do have this even match in the case of the Quran. And now this second coincidence, where 57 surahs give us the numbers which, when totaled, is the same as the number of verses in the entire Quran. Now, I've tested this, as I mentioned last night, with the 73 books of the Bible, and in no case did the 73 books of the Bible give us this result. So we're dealing with a remote coincidence. Would this not support the Muslim view that the Quran is a revelation from the Almighty God? Or would you say that this is just simply a coincidence? And if you say it is a coincidence, how do you account for Christian miracles, which atheists will say are just simply coincidences as well? Tell us.
Okay, using my two criteria, specified and complex, what you expressed there, I'd be willing to concede complexity, but I'm not willing to concede specification. Now, the way you explained it there, I think that's given me a better understanding of it. When the surah number and the number of verses in it are added together, you then look at the ones that you divide them into. So you've got all those, you've got 114 totals, and you need a method to divide them into two groups. Okay, what could that method be? So you said the method was correct me if I'm wrong, if they're both even or both odd, they go in one group. If it's one of each, they go in the other group. Okay. How many other ways could there have been of dividing those up?
Okay, I mentioned that last night. Did you read this book, Symmetric Book?
Okay, let me finish up. So instead of that, you could have said the odd numbered surahs, the even numbered surahs. You could have said the odd totals, the even totals, which would have been more natural things to do. They would have been simpler and more obvious things to do. And so I would be extremely confident in saying that's what was tried first. That didn't work out so well. So then it went on to the other alternative. Now, in terms of it coming out as 57 odd, 57 even, if that hadn't happened, if it had come out 59, 55, would that have been evidence that it wasn't God? See, there's no pre-existing hypothesis there. If that hadn't worked out, you wouldn't be here talking about it. But because that's the one that did work out, it goes onto the list. And we get that. Now, you talked about testing it on the Bible. I would say, of course, it's not going to work on the Bible. Because the first thing that Muslims tried on the Quran in this regard as well, that didn't work either. They had to try another version and another version and another version. And that, we're talking about one particular group of approaches. And within that group of approaches, you have several attempts, and one of them gives what can appear to be a startling result. That's within one group of approaches. How many other groups of approaches that yielded no fruit were tried as well? You see, we don't hear anything about that. I think we've got results being presented, and then there's a colossal waste paper bin of all the failed ones that's out of sight, and we're just presented with the ones that work. So I think testing that on the Bible obviously isn't the way to do it.
Okay, so my point about testing it on the Bible is that first we form a hypothesis. We notice a pattern in the Quran. Despite all failures, now we have arrived at something which is a remarkable pattern. But we want to know why does the verses of the Quran have this, the chapters of the Quran have these many verses. Now we find a mathematical pattern that links the chapter numbers with the number of verses in those chapters. And we're asking how remote is this? Is this a regular occurrence? And we test 73 other books, whether of the Bible or any other book, and we find that it does not occur in those other books. That confirms our observation that this is a remarkable coincidence. And you ask how many different ways are there of dividing it. This is what this book is about, actually. This book divides the chapters into two groups based on whether the numbers are prime, based on whether the numbers are divisible by 2, based on whether the numbers are divisible by 3. Well, numbers divisible by 2, we've already spoken about odd or even. That's what odd or even is about. But numbers that are divisible by 3, numbers that are divisible by both 2 and 3 at the same time, numbers that are neither divisible by 2 nor by 3, numbers that are divisible by 2 but not by 3, numbers that are divisible by 3 but not by 2, prime numbers, perfect numbers, abundant numbers, deficient numbers. This author has gone through the same similar analyses with a wide array of methods of separating the two surahs, the two groups of surahs, and in each case he comes up with a remarkable coincidence. Moreover, when the Quran is divided into two sections, the first 57 surahs, the second 57 surahs, we find that these patterns play out between the two sections. So in the end, we find that there is such an interlocking system that governs how many verses are in each chapter, that if any one of the numbers had been changed, the entire system falls apart. This is an assurance, first of all, that this did not occur by chance. If it's by chance, it's a very remote chance. And because it occurs within this religious context, the best explanation for it is God. And secondly, that nobody muddled the numbers subsequently, otherwise the whole system would have been destroyed.
Yeah, my response, I mean, you mentioned various types of numbers. You didn't mention triangular numbers, square numbers, cubes, Fibonacci sequence, etc., etc. But from my point of view, to quote more examples doesn't address my central point. Because to my mind, as I explained with these books are claiming to support the truth of the Old and New Testament by finding the sort of patterns that you're talking about. But when part two comes out, I don't need to go and read part two, because I know the method already. I know the flaw in the method, and so I wouldn't bother to read it unless they can show me that, there's something fundamentally different in their approach. So I think to present more examples of it, to my mind, it isn't addressing the central issue, which is the method of try it. If it works, put it on the list. If it doesn't work, leave it out. Now, it doesn't matter how complex and how many times you repeat that and how many patterns you find, that method is flawed.
Well, you're speaking of a flawed method if you're asking about a pure probability. But of course, there's pure probability, there's statistical probability, and also subjective probability. If we think of subjective probability for the moment, that has a lot to do with the nature of the subject that you're studying. One says, okay, based on what I know of this subject, there's a very remote chance that it should come out like this. And if it comes out like this, this is remarkable. So we're dealing with that situation here, knowing the history of the Quran, how it came to be written down, how the verse numbers eventually came to be put in. It is remarkable that the verse numbers generate this kind of result. And then once we see that this is the way of studying the Quran by separating them into two sections of surahs, and then even dividing the Quran into two halves, first 57, last 57 chapters of the Quran, and then we apply a wide variety of tests using so many different kinds of numbers, you're saying, okay, what about Fibonacci numbers? Well, be my guest, test it based on Fibonacci numbers and tell us what your results are. But now you want to imagine that the authors had some failures. I'm not denying that. That's easy to imagine. The authors had some failures. But the point is, once they have hit upon a method, they find that consistently that method generates very amazing results. Like, for example, the one word nufikha, which is mentioned in the Quran, when Abdullah ibn Kahil concatenated the numbers relating to the verse where this word is mentioned, first the verse numbers and then the chapter numbers, we come up with a remarkable occurrence of numbers. The first one being a multiple of 7 squared, the second one being a multiple of 7 to the power of 4. A double remarkable coincidence. How do you account for all of this?
Okay, the last one you're explaining, I don't know that particular example. Could you just clarify for me, is that you're talking about one particular word?
Yes.
Okay, could you explain to me that one particular miracle associated with that word?
Yeah, I don't mind explaining that to you, Richard, but I hope that my point would be registered about competence for getting into this debate. See, yes, I don't know much about astrology, and I don't believe in astrology, but if I wouldn't get into a debate about astrology without studying the subject from the point of view of one who actually believes in it already, because I want to know what their arguments are and why they believe in it before I enter into a debate. Okay. Because in studying that, maybe I'll become convinced that astrology is a science, and that's true.
Okay, that's fine. I'll respond without it being replied. Because the principle applies regardless. You're saying that there's some particular miracle associated with that particular one word.
Yes.
And then for another particular word, it's not applying the same system. There's a different system for showing, a different form of calculation and system for showing the miracle with another word. What would be truly impressive, which would be truly complex, would be if that same system for that one word applied for every word in the Quran.
Yes,
because
that would
be... you have to have a different method for that word. I mean, I came across something when I was doing research for this. Someone said that the letters of nitrogen, the Arabic word that appears to be sort of closest to nitrogen, it appears once in the Quran, I think it was in Surah 18, verse 39, and the ratio of the mass of nitrogen to something or other was 1,839. They're saying it's a miracle. What do you think of that?
Well, that's not one of the things that I presented, so I'd like to concentrate on the things that I presented.
Just to say, to my mind though, I can see that it's just an example of finding a one-off coincidence, someone searching and searching, and they've found something that seems significant, so they present it. I think it's just coincidence.
Yeah, but see, I'm not presenting one-off coincidences. I'm presenting things which are based on a whole background of research. But I'm giving some examples of this research which can be conveyed to a popular audience given the media with which we are working. So to reply to just these examples in the way you have done, it is not really to grasp the whole subject. You have to grasp the whole subject and then respond to it. And to say you've read these books about the attempts to prove that the Bible has these correspondences, that doesn't do the job, because this is saying because it didn't work for the Bible, because people made some lofty claims about the Bible and those claims have been demolished and we don't no longer regard them to be true, that doesn't mean that the claims you are making about the Quran are not true. So one has to study this particular subject to know it well. So in my presentation, you notice that I looked at contrasting words, words which are clearly contrasting, like hot and cold, man and woman, in the case of Jesus and Adam, because the Quran makes that specific mention of the relationship between the two. I mentioned angels and demons, which are clearly contrasting terms. Dunya and Akhirah, this life, the life hereafter, which for believers are contrasting. I didn't mention some of the types of examples that you mentioned where there is some link, okay, cross and Jesus. So it's not really contrasting terms that you have found in the Old and New Testaments. So you're actually responding to something else there. Now, coming back to what you asked me about, this particular word in the Quran, nufikha, which means it's blown into, is mentioned 7 times in the Quran. So from the point of view of one who is looking for things that are patterned on 7, this becomes an interesting word right off the bat. Now, when this word is located in the Quran, it is found that there are 6 verses in which the word occurs, because it occurs twice in one particular verse. The verse numbers, when merged together, when concatenated, is the technical word for that, as you know, it gives us a word which appears to be random, but it is a product of 7 squared, which we know that a random word, a random number being a product of 7 squared, the probability of that is 1 over 49. And when we concatenate the chapter numbers in which this word occurs, we get a large number. And you're right, the size of the word doesn't matter, because every 7th number is going to be a multiple of 7. But now, this number is a multiple of 7 to the power of 4. And the possibility of that, getting a random number to be that multiple, is 1 out of 2,401. So to get this joint probability, the probability is 1 out of 117,000. Which is that denominator is greater than the number of words in the Quran itself. So we're talking about some remarkable examples that are found, and it's not only one example. But yes, this is an example of one word, and yes, I don't have another word like this to show a similar remarkable example. But when we look at all of the remarkable examples that we have of these mathematical patterns in the Quran, we put them all together, one stands in awe at this book, that this is a revelation from the Almighty God. It seems hard to think that all of these came about by simple random choice, by random chance.
See, the volume of miracles produced. Remember when I showed the method, what I said was the method. The final step of the method was repeat ad infinitum. Just keep doing it. Just keep looking. The longer people keep looking, the more of these things they'll find, because there's a virtually infinite way of messing around with the huge database of numbers that can be generated from the Quran. I've joined a Facebook group just recently of some Muslims who are talking about the numerical miracles in the Quran, and virtually daily people are coming up with new ones, and that's just by the simple application of this. So I think for you to present any more or suggest that there's a particular extra time, it's just other applications of this same method. You said about my books here, these people have used similar arguments for the Old Testament and for the New Testament. You said they've been refuted. But they've been refuted by exactly the argument that I presented today. That the problem with these books is exactly the same as the problem with the numerical miracles, alleged numerical miracles in the Quran. It's the same logical error that's been made.
I'll mention two things in response to that. First of all, as you would know from reading those books, that one of Ivan Panin's problems is that he didn't specify which version of the Bible he was using. And that means that one cannot really study his results, because if you don't know which version, and there's so many versions, this is a problem. And as you know, in my work, I have specified that I'm dealing with the 1924 Egyptian edition of the Quran, which has now become popular among Muslims, even though Muslims don't think of it as that under that designation, but that's the academic designation for that particular edition. So I'm specifying my edition. Moreover, the method of counting has been specified in great detail on the website islamnoon.com. So all of this is now open and it's plain. And one of the problems with Ivan Panin was this, he did not specify. Moreover, with Ivan Panin, as Ellis has pointed out in his criticism, Ivan Panin, if he doesn't find the seven occurring someplace, then he goes to the neighboring number. And if you go to the neighboring number on each side, then you have 3 out of 7 chances that your number will be a multiple of 7. And 3 out of 7 is close to 50%, and so your chance is greatly increased. And so you're not really proving anything remarkable. Now, I haven't gone this route. Last night you attempted to show that I've gone that route by using the inclusive difference, but my response to that is that this is a consistent recurring pattern in the Quran, that when we're dealing with differences, it is the inclusive difference that actually gives us the results. And now, if you do that by sevens, what explains the recurrence of things about on the pattern of 19 in the Quran? Because 19 is a more remote number than 7. It's only every 19th number that is a product of 19. And now we find that whereas we looked at the number of chapters and the number of verses within each chapter from one particular aspect, now we can look at it from a different aspect. 114 happens to be a product of 19. It is 19 times 6. And the basmala, which is at the beginning of every chapter but one, it comprises 19 letters. The basmala is not written at the beginning of the 9th chapter, but it's found twice in the 27th chapter. And the inclusive difference between these two chapters from 9 to 27 is actually 19. And so you're finding the 19 recurring over and over and over again. The first chapter that's said to be revealed to the Prophet Muhammad, peace be upon him, it is now placed 19th from the end. It's the 96th chapter of the Quran. Only the first 5 verses were said to be revealed to him initially. And these first 5 verses comprise 76 letters, which is a product of 19. It's 19 times 4. The entire chapter has 19 verses. And the entire chapter comprises 285 letters, which is 19 times 15. Yeah, so how do you explain all of this?
Yeah, can I just return to my dice rolling analogy? I got a 5, then another 5, then another 5, then another 5, then and I could have got the cup full of dice, rolled it again, got another 5 and another 5. That's the method. I just like to go back to my summary of the method for finding the arithmetic coincidences. Where are we? Now, what Shabir was criticizing these books here, Panin's work in particular, he was criticizing it on point 4. He was saying there's fudge in it somehow. There's a bit of fiddling going on. When I presented that, I said, you could deny 4, but even if you take number 4 out, the method is still flawed. And I think that's the central point. I think that's the point that Shabir isn't able to answer. Is the method of select an arbitrary quantity to count, look for some particular result with it. If it works, put it on the list. If it doesn't, try again and keep looking until you find some more. And also, if we could just go back to the question of significance. Shabir was saying that the word count coincidences in the Quran were of particular significance, and he was saying that mine weren't. I've got to dispute that in the strongest possible terms. The New Testament, mercy and judgment and cross. Okay, you find me a Christian who says, no, I can't see any significance there. I can't see how that relates to the message of the New Testament. Look at my ones from the Quran. Christians doubt the revelation, the message. If that's not significant, if you can't see meaning in that, surely, would any Muslim like to say, no, I can't see any meaning in that. I don't know how, I can't see how that relates to the message of the Quran and the Muslim faith at all. I think there is significance from that. When I was doing this, I went through the lemma frequency list, and it might say, once mentioned 15, there'd be a big list of them. And from those 15, I chose the ones that did have significance. That was my method. I'm open about my method. I chose the ones that seemed to make some sense, that had some significance. So I think Shabir is incorrect to say mine don't show any significance. I think they do.
Well, what I was time of the discussion period.
Okay. Yeah, you can answer.
I was just going to say that I was talking about contrasting words, and these are not necessarily contrasting words.
Okay, I would say to that, the fact that are there any contrasting ones in my Quran ones?
Well, the very fact you have to look for them means that you don't have a significant number of such contrasting words to present. Sorry. Plus, you're dealing with the Bible, which is several times greater than the Quran in terms of size. The Quran is about 1/5 the size of the New Testament, and the New Testament itself is much shorter than the Old Testament.
A large size actually makes it harder to find them. Because the more times a word's going to be used, if you're looking for a match with higher numbers, then there's less probability that it's going to happen. Like we saw for Muhammad, there were lots of other words used four times. My Old Testament one, 1,075 uses for one. So a big book actually doesn't help you to find word matches. It makes it more difficult. I mean, the odds of getting a match with them used over 1,000 times, the probability is much lower. And getting the ones that you looked at.
Yeah, I know our moderator has said that the time for the discussion is up, but if we can be allowed, I think a very significant part of our discussion tonight is to get to the question of how you evaluate Christian miracles, because I didn't come here to debate with an atheist, and much of what you presented is the kind of critical skepticism an atheist will bring to such a discussion. But as a Christian, I take it that you believe in some miracles, like let's say the virginal conception of Jesus as an example. And as you know, atheists will say, well, you know, no such thing happens. Maybe Mary was impregnated by some Roman soldier raping her. One might even conceive of other ways in which Mary could have been impregnated, but all natural ways. What would be your response to that, and how would you defend this as a miracle if you're taking the kind of critical, skeptical stance that you have taken here today?
I think my skeptical stance is towards the Quran. I'm someone who needs to be convinced that the Quran is a revelation from God. So I am skeptical from that point of view. But I think what you're saying is if you need to add the ingredient of faith in order to be able to interpret this evidence, to interpret these facts as evidence that God's behind the Quran, doesn't that make it quite circular? Doesn't that take away its value in apologetics? Because you use, correct me if I'm wrong, you seem to use the numerical miracles in the Quran as an apologetic device to convince people of the divine origin of the Quran. And I think if a degree of faith is necessary to see that, and I think that undermines it. I think the design inference, as I laid it out, that doesn't depend on any faith assumptions. I think that's a purely rational, logical process to go through. And I think following the design inference process, I think the numerical miracles of the Quran as presented, that they fall short of meeting the criteria.
But you are aware that atheists question the whole enterprise of intelligent design, and they say that faith believers are starting with the presumption that God exists, and they're saying that presumption is even more remote. And
they are. Yeah, but so you've got to look at the criteria, specification and complexity. And in biological systems, I see specification and complexity to a huge degree, massive degree, so blatant that it's, to my mind, undeniable. So it's a very, very clear case.
I don't want to deny you and sound like the atheist myself, but I want to just remind you that atheists do have a comeback to all of this. They will say that no matter what designs you're looking at, if you're dealing with a universe as vast as it is, then you are going to find evidence of design. But again, they're saying that we faith believers are doing what you did with the dice, where you just roll some dice and you just pick the ones that give you the result that you desire. And I would say that that's not what we have done with the Quran. And if you study these documents in depth, you will see that that's not what actually has been done with the Quran. Surely there have been failures, but once a pattern has been found, we have found that there are many examples that fit the same pattern. Too many to credit all of this to mere chance. And obviously, the reason that we are getting the 19s and the 7s and the contrasting words and the patterns between the chapter number and the number of verses within each chapter and so on, and you didn't say anything about the words that have numerical values in the Quran, and my formula with Moses times the frequency plus Aaron times the frequency equals 19 times Moses plus Aaron. And the number of times Aaron is mentioned in the Quran, the verses where it's mentioned, all adding up to 377 within the four chapters. Uh-huh. And then the chapter numbers where Aaron is mentioned, all add up to 377, which means Moses plus Aaron again. So that the recurrence of this 377 in the various ways, this is remarkable. You didn't say anything about that. And that's only one example of using the numerical equivalents of letters and words in the Quran.
Yeah, I mean, the last one, I think in terms of presenting more cases, from my point of view, that doesn't move things forward at all, because it's the same method behind them. Now, evolution was an interesting example. Now, I think the design inference from biological systems is absolutely clear, yet atheists deny it. But in that situation, atheists don't have an alternative. Okay. Whereas in this case, I think you could convince an atheist of intelligent input. Remember my example, if the prime numbered letters from the beginning of the Quran spelt out the Shahada, no fudging it, just straightforward, that's what it did. I think an atheist would look at that and they would infer design. But in this case, they have got an alternative. They'd say someone fixed it. So I would say, if you can convince an atheist that someone must have rigged it, then I would say that your argument is effective for them. But I think an atheist wouldn't be convinced of that.
But by the way, I didn't understand last night that I was saying that if we had a consistent pattern throughout the Quran, we would think that somebody rigged it. What I intended to say, even if I said it the wrong way, is that whereas I thought I heard you say that this should have been specified from the inception, like what patterns are we looking for, and I said that if this was specified from the inception, then we would think that somebody specified this and then they fixed the Quran to meet that specification. The fact that we're discovering this in hindsight, meaning that we already have the finished book and we don't know what to look for in the Quran, but we start noticing things and then we are struck by the complexity of the observations which we stumble upon, and then we ask for an explanation for this, and the best explanation seems to be that God revealed this. So we're working from this backward angle. That's what I was explaining. I didn't understand myself to be saying that if the whole, like the same consistent pattern was found throughout, then that would be proof that it was fudged or meddled with.
Okay. In terms of the specification, I have more in mind that if someone is going to do one of these tests, so you've come up with a procedure to follow, and then you try it, the scientific method would be that you publicize in advance what you're going to try, and then you do it, and you then publicize the results. Whereas the difference here is that it's in advance, the hypothesis is not put forward, that if we do this calculation and the answer divides by 19, that will be further evidence that the Quran is inspired by God. That is not put forward. It's tested first and then only presented if it's happened. If you put forward the hypothesis first, then if it turns out not to be, then logically that would have to be some evidence against it. But that process doesn't happen.
But you have to appreciate what has happened with Muslims. Muslims, for example, you'll find in some classic commentaries on the Quran that the commentator, for example, Imam al-Razi, says that, well, there are 19 letters that spell Bismillahir Rahmanir Rahim. And he says, well, you know, there are 19 angels guarding the hellfire, as mentioned in Surah 74, verse number 30. And it looks like there is one of these letters for each one of the angels. So one starts to make these connections. And as Muslims are reading through like a majum like this, you're reading through this, and you're looking for a word, and it tells you at a glance how many times that word occurs in the Quran. So now you're looking up shaitan for whatever reason, because you're planning a sermon and you want to speak about the devil. So you find out that right away you see this 88. And you happen to want to include angels, so you look for the verses that deal with angels, and you go to the word for angels, and you see that's also 88. So it strikes you. What makes this 88 and 88? You're talking about this life and the life hereafter, so you want to find the verses that deal with that. You go to this life, it's 115. You go to the life hereafter, it's 115 as well. So it strikes you that there is a pattern developing here, like how did this come out like this? So now you start with the observation, and then you extrapolate and say, well, it looks like all of this is divinely planned. And it's not only these simple observations of the correspondence of the number of times words are used in the Quran, but now going deeper, the number of verses within each chapter, because the number of verses within each chapter has been a puzzle for Orientalists for a long time. They've tried to ascertain what is the secret behind this arrangement. Why are the larger verses at the beginning, the shorter verses at the end, even though this is not the historical sequence in which it was revealed? And they said, okay, whoever arranged the Quran must have decided to put the larger verses at the beginning, the shorter verses at the end. But that's what they said. But that's not a correct description of what has happened here, because obviously the shortest verse of the Quran is not the last verse, it's the 108th verse. It should have been the 114th if that was the method. And we can see, if we go through the Quran, very frequently a shorter chapter is followed by a longer one.
It's roughly the case. My point was, if you add together the number of verses to the number of the surah, I said the totals you get will be clustered. That's all I said. I didn't claim any more than that. The fact that they're clustered means that then when you divide them into two groups, by whatever means you want to, the answers you get are going to be fairly similar to each other. That's the only point I was making there.
True. And of course, with that explanation, you're starting with the fact that there is this correspondence, and you're thinking, if somebody wanted to do this, how would they do it? Well, this is the way to do it. But somebody had to have in mind, I want to do this. And who had in mind to do this? It's only God we can think of, because no human being in the history of the Quran's collection and promulgation had in mind to make it come out like this. We're only discovering it in hindsight.
Yeah. I'm happy to leave it at that. I think we've had a good discussion. So,
we're just going to have the closing statements from each representative. So first we're going to go with Richard Lucas, and then Shabir.
Well, I'd like to thank Shabir. I've learnt a lot today. I think this is a topic where I was quite frustrated that I couldn't find any examples of Shabir having debated this topic. I don't know if it has before. So I've learnt a lot more from last night's debate and today. I think I've learnt more about the topic. I think I've already laid out my case, but just to conclude, I'm quite a Sherlock Holmes fan. I haven't got the direct quote, I only thought of it this morning. But Sherlock Holmes would often make inferences, and he'd say, oh, that person must be a blacksmith. And Dr. Watson would say, oh, that's amazing. How did you know that? That's unbelievable. And Sherlock Holmes would say, well, all I did is, I didn't tell you about the in-between steps that led up to my conclusion. If you knew about the method I used, you wouldn't really have been that impressed. And I think that's what we've got here. I think Shabir's tried to shroud it in a mystique that's very technical, it's very complicated, I don't really understand it, everyone watching this probably doesn't really understand it. But the basic method is clear. Try things, if it works, keep it. If it doesn't work, then you must have been using the wrong test. Try a different one. If it does succeed, then it's a sign of the hand of God. I wouldn't describe these as numerical miracles, I would describe them as arithmetic coincidences. And I think it's highly significant that the sort of things in these books, serious Christian apologists, Christian academics, the Christian equivalents of Shabir, if you like, they really don't touch this. They see through it, and they can see that while it might have some appeal at a popular level, they can see that it's basically flawed, and they don't use it. And I think it's a real anomaly there, and I think it's a really interesting question why in Islam this sort of argument, this sort of material is regarded as very convincing, whereas exactly equivalent material within Christianity is dismissed from the arena of serious academic apologetics. Thank you.
So for my final 2 minutes closing, let me say, folks, that I'm so glad you joined us for this debate. And I'm so glad we did it. Let's do it again. Thank you all for joining us. And I hope that in the end, we can be friends. So we differ theologically, but let's unite in humanity. As for the points that were raised, I have shown that the Quran has very complex numerical patterns interlacing with each other. And the level of complexity is so staggering that the best explanation for this is that it is a revelation from God. Richard answered by saying, well, you know, you can find that in another book. And he hasn't shown the level of complexity that I talked about with regards to the Quran. You can find some other coincidences in some other book. But coincidences in a book are not by themselves proof that the book is from God, nor does a book from God have to have these numerical patterns. It's just that when we find it in the Quran, we need to have an explanation for how these patterns came about. And there are two basic explanations, either by chance or by design. It's not by chance, because the chance is so remote, it looks like design. And it's not by a human design, and obviously it's by a divine design. Richard answered by saying, well, look, we have had this with the Bible, people championed this, and then it was discounted. But in fact, the fact that it was discounted in the case of the Bible and disproved in the case of the Bible doesn't mean that we should presume that it will be disproved in the case of the Quran as well. On the other hand, what we find in the case of the Quran is that not only me, but there are many academics and scholars among Muslims who are actually championing this view. You will find a burgeoning of new internet websites and Facebook pages dealing with the numerical miracles of the Quran and books that are being published, and I shared with you information about some of these resources earlier. You can go to my own website, QuranSpeaks.com, where you will find that I have discussed this in length in some of our television broadcasts. Thank you all very much. See you next time.